Hello and welcome to ESPN Cricinfo's video cast with me, Ravi Chandran, Ashwin, and of course I'm going to ask him now about fingerspin and its place in the evolving nature of cricket. We see T20 cricket, small grounds and heavy muscular men. Finger spinners, will they survive? I remember being very proud as a commentator and an analyst when at the Wankhede Stadium against England, you bowled a top spinner, not the dusra, the top spinner. And I said, God, and I immediately, you know, that is what I, you know, take pride in. That is why I love my job. I said, let's put all Ashwin's variations there. And I saw that ball, which was a new one. I've seen all your other variations. You've got your one finger seam off spinner. You've got your carom ball. And this was a regular top spinner. And I find very, you know, it is one of the harder balls to bowl. And I remember asking you that. And you bowled maybe one or two balls in the whole test match. You won the man of the match award, I think, for that particular test match. This bag of tricks, do they come easily to you? Because one important thing is you've got these four or five variations, but very often, especially in test matches, you land them on the spot. Accuracy is never an issue with you, which is, you know, remarkable for somebody who does so many variations. For a guy who doesn't do any variations, he's got no other sort of strength, he's got to be accurate. So you've got all these variations, but you never see them all over the place. So just explain this to us.
See, when I started playing first class cricket, Sanjay, Raman, I'm sure you know of W.B. Raman.
W.B., yeah.
I rate him highly, and I'm not even surprised he's the coach of the women's team now.
Okay, wow.
When I started my first class career, I played with a certain set of cricketers who were extremely talented like me in a similar age group, which was Yo Mahesh, who played for under-19 India, Aniruddha Srikanth, who played under-19 India, and all these sort of guys. And we played first class cricket together. So Raman was all about being extremely disciplined, and he would take nothing less than a throw right above the stumps for a keeper. Okay, and if while fielding practice, if one couldn't get the throw into the keeper's hand for the first time, he would yell, and the second time he would actually reprimand you, which is probably a little old stylish in how Mumbai cricket was like. In a lot of ways, I think some cricketers understood this. In saying some, I would just say me. I understood this because when I was having a conversation, I had the courage to go and ask him, because he would be very dismissive sometimes. So when I went and asked him, sir, why are you asking to do this? It puts certain people under fear when they're practicing. He said, when I put pressure in on you at practice, if you can't deliver, then how are you going to respond to the pressure in a game?
Yeah.
One. And secondly, when I went to the Indian team, when I got my first opportunity, my throws used to be on top of the stump. Mm. Two, and he always maintained, as a spinner, whatever I bowl, if I wake up at 3 o'clock in the night, if I cannot hit the top of the bat, then I got no chance. And in the net, he would be behind me every single time. And in fact, he used to master my rhythm. He was the first person who, with or without his knowledge, inculcated this habit of self-conscious training inside me. He said, he'll keep telling me, you're running 10% slower, you're running 15% faster, you're running this many. And so, obviously, to latch onto this and understand is my own thinking. But these are things that I would never forget in my career. And it just held me in such good stead when I started playing first-class cricket, and I valued him so much. But because he could be a little strict and he could be a little dismissive, he could put pressure on people, started, you know, sort of moving away from him. But those who moved away were the ones who eventually suffered.
So that discipline was there in your DNA very early. I mean, variations, yes, but it's important to land them in the right places. So that was a given.
He was such an open person. In fact, when I started bowling the carom ball with a cricket ball, it used to land horribly wrong. And when people were batting in the nets, they used to hit it with one hand, dismiss it and get irritated and all that. He quietly came to me and said, what are you doing? I said, sir, I bowl this with a tennis ball. I'm trying to bowl it with a cricket ball. He just took me aside, and for someone who's so strict and all that, and so disciplined, he took me aside and said, okay, now bowl it in this net, you know, open net. I kept bowling. He said, no, you're not bowling to the batsman today. Just bowl this as much as you want. So I bowled like the entire 2 hours. My fingers started paining a little bit. I came back and said, Ashwin, you know what? There are two things. One, you should respect the other person's practice, what he wants to achieve out of the practice. And two, if you want to respect your own practice and if you want to achieve something, it's always in isolation. When you can get it into your head, you will be able to split both of these and be a team man and also an individual man who wants to excel. So these are lessons that I will always cherish. And if I can pass a wee bit of this to somebody else, I would have done my job.
When we are talking about new ball bowlers, And you've got Jimmy Anderson, wonderful new ball bowler. And I keep saying, let's not forget another one, Ravichandran Ashwin. He's a brilliant new ball bowler in test matches. So tell us about this, because we grew up thinking, you know, new ball was meant for spin bowlers and the spinners loved it when the ball was rough and old. But Ashwin, when you look at the records as well, has one of the best new ball, you know, records.
See, the one thing I really enjoy about the new ball is the kind of fist that you get. Whatever you get happens quickly. One of my innate strengths is to be able to put a lot of revs on the ball. So when I can put those revs and the ball is hard, it just responds better off the pitch, which is one.
You're talking about the seam or the leather also?
The leather also. And sometimes what happens is, because I can change the seam positions to how I want to change it, even when I get the skid on the ball, it just skids, you know, a little
what
bit.
About the grip? Gripping is not a problem?
Yeah, the first, I generally like to use the arm ball in the first two or three overs that I bowl with a new ball, because if you use that arm ball, what happens is the batsman's both edges are being challenged and it goes really late in the air. So, I really try and use it to my advantage, and the batsman going across the line also is basically rendered very risky if you can get that under. So, you can sneak it under. And there is one which I get, that the floater that swings, the other one which can just pitch and just go out, and the other one where it land on the seam and then get it to go the other way. So, these balls become extremely effective, because if what happens is as the ball grows, gets older, the time that you get to adjust for something made as a mistake in technique can be countered, or it might not carry to the fielder or whatever. So that with the new ball hastens, and because I don't take much time to get into my rhythm, because of the awareness I've got about how I need to keep the process very simple, I get into it very quickly. And what I do is when I'm bowling with the new ball, I try and use my middle finger a lot more compared to the index finger. And when I go use the older ball, I try and get over the top. Sometimes I don't use the index finger to go over the top. It's behind and I still put the revs. And that's when the ball actually goes the other way.
So finally, I want to get into fingerspin, Ashwin. And T20 cricket. Future of fingerspin, IPL, T20 cricket. Small ground, strong people. Dusra. What a great piece of ammunition that was for Ashwin. Thakleen Mushtaq used to bowl the slog overs for Pakistan in a small ground in Canada, because he had the Dusra, where obviously you can't bowl it anymore. That ammunition is gone. How does a finger spinner like you, Mohammad Nabi is another example, survive? I mean, you've tried a lot of things. You've put your, you know, body to the test, your skills and everything. We've seen everything. You bowl leg spin and, you know, all that. But I'm sure you perhaps can tell us how finger spin is going to evolve in the next 2-3 years. I don't see the grounds getting bigger and the batsman not getting any weaker.
I'm very surprised that when the last IPL happened, that people hadn't picked up what I was doing. A lot of people was talking about a carom ball, but I was never bowling the carom ball. I was bowling the reverse carom. When I was bowling the reverse carom, I get a lot out of the pitch. Sometimes it can spin, sometimes I can get it to skid, and sometimes I can get it to duck back into the...
You have to now slightly demonstrate now this reverse carom ball. Okay.
So what happens... It keeps coming the same way like a carom, but it starts spinning in the backward direction.
Towards
me. So it probably looks like when you're looking at the front, it's coming like this. And so what it does is it can skid. And if I tilt the seam position, it can break. And the worst thing is if I can change the arm path, it will 100% break one way or the other, either in or outside. So in T20 cricket, my off spin is the variation for a right hander. Okay,
and there's no choice, right?
And I
you
haven't.
You can't bowl 5 or 6 off spinners.
It's not possible. Let's just face the reality. In T20, in T20 cricket, I think you need to call yourself a bowler. There will be a time where you need to be able to bowl a bouncer as well as a spinner. You saw Qais Ahmed how he took Russell by surprise in the T10 league.
Yeah.
In my book, those who are going to talk about spin, finger spin, wrist spin, why is wrist spin successful? It's not because it's challenging both edges of the bat. It's because of the unpredictable nature of the leggies who are bowling different lengths without their awareness. Sometimes they bowl lengths, they want to land it somewhere, they want to bowl it up, and they end up yorking the batsman by mistake. All these things is what keeping wrist spin extremely relevant, and the unpredictable nature of the game needs to be grasped by cricketers and to be able to deliver the unpredictable nature. Now imagine somebody is delivering unpredictable stuff like how the wrist spinner is dishing out. What if you can dish out unpredictable stuff in a very aware manner? And that's the journey I have taken about, and that's exactly why I found myself amongst the wickets and extreme control last year when I was bowling at Mohali, which is very, very challenging. and it was very, very difficult for people to line me up. If you can, in T20 cricket or any format of the game, if it's white ball, you cannot hunt wickets down. You can hunt wickets down unless and until people are not picking you. But that's a very novel stage of your career, which I have been in as well. But post that, you should be able to dish out things at will that surprise the batsman. You should be able to stay relevant and keep them, you know, once you keep them guessing, the chances of them bossing you is very little. So that's the journey.
Do you think there is future for somebody who is essentially an off-spinner if he goes away from his off-spin and just calls himself a spinner? Now, for example, what would you call Sunil Narayan?
See,
if you were given the option of captioning Sunil Narayan, what would you say? Wrist spinner, finger spinner, off spinner, leg spinner, what is
Sunil, Sunil Narayan had this issue with his action sometime back.
Yeah, yeah.
And ever since his carom ball has not been the same. So he's been pretty much the same, but his off break still spins. I just feel the utilization of his off break at optimum levels of lines and lengths going is forward is going to be the success. Let's say, let's talk about a finger spinner. Can a finger spinner in six balls bowl different lines and lengths, keeping the batsman in check? That can happen only if a finger spinner is aware of his action and aware of his release points, aware of his contact.
What about the angle of change that a spinner gets after the ball is pitched? That's where the miss hit happens, and that's why perhaps wrist spinners have an advantage because they can change the angle of the ball with their googly or, you know, the extra bounce and stuff, which a finger spinner cannot as much. And you know, when there's somebody hitting with a heavy bat to the arc, you really want to miss the entire face of the bat of Pollard because you can't just hit the slightly outer edge of the bat or the inside because that ball will still go
Let's take this into complete perspective. When you're talking about wrist spin, the variation lands in how much the wrist surrounds the ball and how much of revolutions the wrist is putting behind the ball, and then how the finger takes over from there. If both are in cognizance, you have the best chance of it spinning more. This is how wrist spin works. And that's where the unpredictability lies. Whatever you're talking about, certain balls can come out in complete cognizance of the wrist and the finger. Certain balls might not. Certain balls might release very badly coming out of the finger, which will fall fuller, which happens a lot of cases with Zampa, where in the recent series when people were lining him up, the ball fell fuller than the ideal length and they got out LBW. Okay. So when you're talking about all these issues together, now we are talking about finger spin, where a lot of finger spinners aren't aware how to change pace. First thing, the change of pace is completely reliant on how many revolutions you're putting on the ball and how you're pacing your wrist. The understanding of finger spin itself is wrong. Finger spinners also can use the wrist. Instead of the 180 that the leg spinners use, the finger spinners can use 90 or even more depending on how supple your wrist is. If you can use both these to your advantage, you can change your pace with respect to however you want. But the first thing...
So can I say this to just round... continue.
So the first thing is the finger spinner needs to understand his action, his rhythm and his loading point and the release point. If all these four things happen, then the finger spinner is in the game.
Yeah, so for a simple mind like mine, I'm concluding that for a finger spinner to survive and revel, he has to dig deeper than a wrist spinner like you have young guys like Rahul Chahar and, you know, these guys coming in and making an impact, or Rashid Khan just coming in. So you think a finger spinner will have to dig deeper? So what about Mohammad Nabi? How do you look at him as a finger spinner?
Mohammad Nabi is a great spinner in T20 cricket. He's not. He is managing to play all over the world, and he's able to do it. And why, Sanjay? Because he's able to change his length and line at will, and that's because he's done the repetitions in Test cricket in the longest format of being able to bowl lengths at will. If you wake him up at 3 o'clock in the night, he'll be able to bowl a length that hits the sticker of the bat. He'll then be able to change his line to wider, to closer, to whatever it is. He can bowl a Yorker. But what's happening with wrist spinners and finger spinners is a complete eradication of logic. Because wrist spinners, why are you not playing wrist spinners in a test match? Because you should be able to bowl a wrist spinner who goes at 2 runs and over, and if not 2.5 and over, and still, isn't he an attacking option in the red ball format as well? Of course he is. But at what cost? That's why the wrist spinners, when they come into the shorter format of the game, they haven't developed the accuracy that a longer format requires, and hence they become extremely useful in the shorter format. So for a finger spinner to be able to do it, he needs, if you want to be an attacking option, he needs to be able to do all the unpredictability that the wrist spinner does in terms of length and line, for which he needs to develop the awareness of himself, of his own bowling. for which he needs to do the volumes that a finger spinner does in a test match scenario.
Right, because you're a thinker, and I'm assuming that you can also look into the future a little bit. Tell us where the sport is heading, Ashwin. You know, where will cricket be after 10, 15 years? Because there aren't too many people playing the sport. Test cricket as a format, the other two challenging, T20 more than 50 overs, ping ball, day-night test matches. How do you look at the health of sports 10 years from now?
Look, Sanjay, I think we find ourselves in very unprecedented times now. So it's very difficult to like put a thing on something and say this is where it might head. But like I said, I made a video yesterday about how the Spanish flu had affected the population 100 years ago and sports survived. But I really hope this pandemic clears in front of us and the game gets back to its feet. But I think we are some distance away. And in terms of the health of world cricket, I think it's going to take longer than what people might assume. But I really do hope that this does not transpire into something where you have more leagues and not much of international cricket. Because the borders are closed. So that's an imminent possibility in the near future, but I don't know what the further future has in store. But definitely, I'd love to get back to playing the game. I miss playing it, and hopefully we can get back to playing.
Right. Final question, just on a personal note. State of mind of Ashwin, are you okay with everything that is happening, not with the current pandemic, but Indian cricket-wise, your career at which you know, point it is not being able to play all three formats, you'll play for a new franchise and all that. So, how is the mind space currently?
See, as far as a T20 cricketer that I am, I think myself as a very hard-earned professional with a T20 format. I'm bloody good at what I do. So, I think wherever I play, I'd be able to deliver. I'll keep reinventing the wheel, and with the experience I've got and the kind of courage that I have, I can keep going for as long as my body is willing it. So, it's about sharpening my edge as the body goes. If my body is in great space, I think test cricket, I just have another streak of great purple patch is what I'm looking at. And the current state of Indian cricket is as healthy as one can find it to be. There's so many reserves of talent, new pools are being thrown in, and the way
team bowlers coming through.
Sure, and the way we have left it is very rich, and I hope we can pick it up from wherever we left once everything.
Yeah, sure.
And the thought of 4-day cricket is something that it doesn't go really well with me, because I'm a spinner and you're taking the fifth day out of the game. So I don't know if it's going to be really healthy from that perspective. And you take out a very fascinating aspect of the game.
Yeah, and what if it rains on day one? You know, that's another thing.
Then maybe they'll play 4 days after that.
Yeah, no, maybe they'll have a reserve day as the fifth day, whatever.
Anyway, but, we're beyond 4 days now. So.
Yeah, correct. Ravichandran, Ashwin, thank you so much. For this chat, I've always wanted to ask you more than 3 questions, and it's been more than 3. And thank you so much. And I think I'm finishing this chat a little more aware. So thank you so much.
Thank you,
and all the best.